Good afternoon. Welcome to my presentation. So we are going to consider again trend following strategies, but the emphasis of my presentation is more on the risk profile. Why trend strategies are popular within institutionals and within high net worth? And what are the conditions for the trend following strategy to perform? So first I start with disclosures. So I'm not affiliated with, so trading in Forex can cause losses. I'm not affiliated with FCM. And the last one that the views are my own, not views of Julius Baer, and that this is not an investment advice. So today we'll talk four very important topics. The first one is risk profile of quantitative strategies, in particular, the skewness and the convexity. The second is what is crisis alpha? Why trend following strategies are so popular? And the next one is I will create a simple toy model to understand how important is the autocorrelation for the performance of trend following strategies. And finally, I will build some indicative trend following system using FX futures. It's because we are in conference sponsored by FX, I'll do some FX illustrations. So quant strategies. There are typically two mainstreams. The first one is carry strategies, and the second trend following. And this, it is shown empirically, given that the data we have, it has been shown by many influential people and funds that these strategies perform well over a long period of time. Each of them has a particular trend generating system. So a carry, it typically looks at the forward spread. In particular, in FX, you look at rates differential. You buy high-yielding currencies, sell low-yielding currencies. Buy Australian dollar, sell Swiss franc. Whereas in trend following, you look at the trend, so you expect, you bet that on the expected performance. Of price performance. And in effect, it would be like we're buying well-performing strategies and selling underperforming strategies, currencies, pairs. So each of them has its own advantages. So for carry, it's very simple. You only look at deterministic spreads most of the time. It also, they perform most of the time. Unfortunately, when they underperform, it will have negative skewness, meaning that gains are small, losses are large. And convexity, meaning that the losses will occur when the market turns down. On the other hand, trend following strategies, they are shown to have positive skewness and convexity, meaning that the timing, the size of gains, and the timing of gains is very good. Drawback is that they tend to underperform over long period of times during range-bound markets. So usually, so the trend following strategies, they trade in liquid future contracts or OTC forwards, and usually diversified, all programs diversified across major asset classes, being stocks, stock indices, fixed income, commodities, and FX. And usually, typical program will trade 50, 100 instruments and across different time horizon. So for fast-paced trend followers have a short look-back window, and slow-paced have long look-back periods. So the biggest CTA hedge funds, Winton, IHL, Aspect, totally in this space is about 250-300 billion. And key benchmark is CG trend following CTAs that I will use in my illustrations. So risk profile of quantitative strategies. So first, the important characteristic is skewness. The skewness measures, negative skewness is when strategy producing series of small gains that are followed by sharp losses. On the other hand, strategies with positive skewness, they generate sequence of small losses that are followed by infrequent large gains. The second is convexity. Convexity with respect to flagship index. It measures when the strategy performs well. So the strategies with positive convexity generate outsized returns when the flagship index has a large positive or large negative returns because of this convexity exposure. This is a quadratic term. And strategies with positive convexity, they produce returns with good timing. When you need it the most, the strategy will perform. So in here I use example. So the talk is about trend following CTAs, but what people argue in this space, is it a long, like CTA is a long volatility strategy or is it a short volatility strategy? And the point is interesting that obviously a natural comparison within the same space is to compare to volatility strategies, right? So first is a short volatility strategy is a carry strategy. You sell option premium, your payoff is limited from above, your losses are unlimited. And bad thing that losses occur at bad periods, right? So here we're comparing X as being return on the S&P 500 and Y as being returns on the strategy. So I use Eureka Hedge indices. So short volatility strategy, it loses both in downside and in upside. It's a classic short convexity strategy, right? On the other spectrum, long volatility strategies, it is true that they have positive skewness, but this meaning that they tend to have large gains. But these gains are not necessarily occur when the market goes down. So they are good strategies, but as a diversifiers to equity risk, they are not. And the green line are tail risk hedge funds. So the tail risk hedge funds, they try to be always long volatility. They are buying off options. They do perform well in downturn markets at the expense of underperforming in good markets because they have delta also. And finally, trend following strategies. And this is particularly interesting that they tend to perform well when the market has sustainable downside trends. That's why people like it. People like it as a diversifiers for equity, for FX, for fixed income. So here again, I'm showing skewness. So obviously, short volatility hedge funds, they have both negative convexity and negative skewness, large negative skewness. At relative value, like long volatility hedge funds, they have positive convexity, but positive skewness, but zero convexity. Meaning that the timing of losses, the timing of gains is not necessarily good. Tail risk hedge funds have large skewness. And surprisingly, trend following strategies on monthly scales, they do not tend to have they have very small skewness on short scales. They have longer skewness on for quarterly, maybe annual returns. And next is performance, right? So in the end, tail risk, why tail risk hedge funds are on the lowest spectrum because they deliver at the expense of underperforming in good markets, right? Obviously, red line is short volatility strategies. They perform well most of the time, but the drawdown are bad. And trend following, they tend to perform well. There are specific conditions when they perform well. And that will be the next part of my presentation. So this is performance, what people also call CTA smile. And CTA smile, we can look at what is trailing sharp on, say, S&P 500, and what is trailing sharp on the strategy, on the CGCTA index, right? So it's obviously a lot of noise, but we see the pattern that if trailing return on S&P is negative, CTAs tend to produce good sharp, right? And they all, on the other spectrum also, it is not harmful. Strong bull markets are not harmful for these strategies. And interesting, like what is also to the point why? Like, is the risk profile of trend following is symmetric or not? That's the question. So in other words, do I expect the same risk profile in very strong bear market or in very strong bull market? As again, they have the trend following perform well in extreme of the market. They don't perform well in mid range of the market. So here I'm just plotting average conditional returns on the CG index versus S&P, right? So this is a smile. What is interesting that the skewness of these conditional returns, right? In strong bull market, it has zero skewness. It has overall, it has skewness of one. Looking at quarterly returns, CTA produce a positive skewness. But this skewness is mostly produced in bear market, right? So, and this why later I introduce a very simple toy model to illustrate this type of behaviors. To summarize, trend following strategies perform well in both strong bull and in strong bear, but the reasons why they produce this performance is different, and therefore risk profile is different. And the risk profile, there is one variable, is autocorrelation. This risk profile can be explained by the autocorrelation. It's again, so here I'm just using a very simple measure of log one autocorrelation between returns, between daily returns, measured on annual scales. And obviously data is noisy, right? So here is a little bit of fitting, but okay, the point is that usually you expect trend following to have very strong returns when autocorrelation is positive, meaning that conditionally the returns are predictable. And in opposite, when returns are mean reverting, meaning that autocorrelation is negative, trend following are expected to perform badly. So here is my toy model. So it's a very simple model. So imagine we have three market dynamics. So the first one is symmetric random walk, equal probability of going up and going down. The first one is a bias drift. The probability of going up is higher, 2/3 versus 1/3 to go down. And the final one is autocorrelated walk. So effectively, if we draw a coin, if it's head, it is more likely that we draw head on the next draw. And then opposite, if it's a tail, it's more likely that we draw a tail on the second route. And so each of them, this has the probabilities, and for each of the market, we compute daily returns. That is just one tick. And then we can also compute trailing annual returns. So each of these market, obviously, we can compute expectations and volatility. So obviously, expected annual return is only positive for bias drift. And obviously, autocorrelated walks they have, tend to have higher volatility. So only positive sharp, so for long only investor, only positive sharp is achieved in biased drift up. So here I use some illustration using the same numbers. So it always has some steps in between these big changes. It has some small steps that are not visible, but it illustrates the framework. So biased drift up always goes up. This blue line is symmetric, so it doesn't move anywhere. And autocorrelated has this tendencies to cluster. And now in these three, in this toy model, we consider three types of traders. So the first one is a noise trader. He will at the end of each day, he will throw a coin. If it's tail, he goes long. Otherwise, he goes short. Just randomly, not looking at anything. Long only investor will be always long. He will always keep his long position. And trend following will look at the size on the sign of today's returns. So if the return is positive, he will buy. If it's negative, he will sell. And for each of these traders, we can compute equity curve, just being daily return times the position that was on previous day. Right, and so here is illustration for symmetric random walk. So obviously, no one is expected to win here. We see that, say, for long only. So say, when market is biased up, obviously, long-only investor outperforms. For noise trader, he is not capturing it because he is just trading the noise. And for trend following also, it's a little bit, there is some performance is generated. But what I do next, I just simulate, so I simulate each of these walks using the same set of random numbers. So it's, the underlying uncertainty will not change, only change it's what is accumulated in market. And then I compute the final realization for each of the traders, right? So, and here are the results, right? So for each trader, I compute expectation over many passes, right? So what is interesting, obviously, so say for noise trader, irrespectively market goes up or down, if it has more bias to go up or it has bias to autocorrelate, results is zero, right? For long only investor, as expected, he performs well when markets tends to have long bias. For trend following is interesting, right? That he also performs well when market drifts up, right? Even though he doesn't know, he just looks, okay, if today is going up, I am buying it, hoping tomorrow will be the same, right? Not as the gain as no, sharp is not as big as for long only. Whereas what happens here when the walk is autocorrelated, right? Long only produces zero because it's a random walk. But trend following gets it. And that's interesting if you want to refresh your probability skills, you can show that for this type of setup, trend follower will always perform as good as long only if the autocorrelation structure persists in the way I described. What is also remarkable is that trend follower also gets positive sharp in biased up drift, even though the underlying reasons are not the same, as not as strong as autocorrelation, right? So now I will show an example of constructing trend following strategies. And it's already easier for me because Rob did a nice job. So this is a little bit refreshing. So first step is transformation and normalization of time series, which to get something that looks the same across many different instruments. And the next step is forecasting. Once time series is normalized, we need to forecast it. Next step is to map signal into position size. Then volatility targeting, effectively sizing the position to equal level of risk. And finally, portfolio. And for this example, I use some FX data, FX futures. Again, this is FX related conferences, so I decided to use this data set. So I use Quandl. I'm not related to Quandl or to this data provider. I just know that they are good. If you don't have resources to do your own, build your own continuous futures, this is a good alternative. And they actually have free data that I will use. It's only available for 10 years, but my goal is illustration. I'm not trying to convince you of any particular strategy. So effectively, I use front month futures that are rolled each month and backward adjusted. So at end of day prices. So here is the sample. So this is it's a dollar performance of being invested in the currency against the dollar. So for pound, it be the P&L is being long GBP USD with P&L marking in dollar, and P&L accounts for both rate differential. So obviously we have mixed performance. So. Delta one strategy equal weighted, so it's some like Aussie dollar performs well, New Zealand dollar. So now I use this data set as for illustration to build up a trend following system. So the first one is building. So there are many ways to scale time series. It's I believe in volatility normalized returns. So what I use so say we can use on trailing basis. Today we can use either daily. We can measure daily return. We can measure weekly return, or monthly return every day. We can also measure intraday volatility of this return, right? And when we normalize, effectively, we normalized return by volatility, we shoot something that get a time series that has units close to unit standard deviation, especially if we use forecasted volatility, right? And here is the example for GBP, for pound future. Because we are in London, so I used sterling as an example. So we see it's, on this step, it's a little bit of smoothing. Using daily, so it's again, it's more like it's kind of a meta parameter that we need to somehow come up. Either we use daily or weekly returns or monthly returns. It has impact on trading frequency, on the turnover. Right, because daily is more volatile, monthly is more stable, and weekly is in between. For both of them, so if we normalize and we just measure the running standard deviation of this time series, they almost one. So theoretically it should be one, right? But because there is all this kind of kurtosis, skewness, so, but it's more or less uniform. And volatility I measure on exponential moving average. I'll come up to it in the next few slides. So here we go. So once we measure return, we measure its volatility, we normalize, we get a time series of volatility normalized returns that looks like maybe a heartbeat or something, you know, like in old radios, you sometimes see the signal. In this one?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you apply in the daily, there's something like a mean reversion strategy when it goes to 2 sigma.
Uh-huh.
You sell, when it goes to minus 2 sigma, you buy.
Yeah, that's the point. This is normalization. So.
Because volatility always reverts to the mean, right? It's the only
yes.
mean reverting, maybe no mean.
Yes. In some ways, to make a stationary time series. That's a good point. Is close to station. Yes. Yes.
So you could apply something like this.
Yes.
Of course, looking bar.
Good. So now we have this signal. So next step is smoothing. So of course there are. It's again. It's a question of what I believe in, right? Do I believe in fixed lookback periods, or maybe I think that something occurred. 10 years ago is still relevant for what can happen today. So why I'm using this exponential moving averages. An exponential moving average in simple version, your weight decays exponentially according to the half-life parameters of your filter. So for example, so here I have different signal half-life. If my half-life is 1 week, so today, the last week, the data from last week will contribute 50% to my signal. If I use a half-life of 1 month, last month will contribute 50% to my signal, and so on. So obviously, if I use a very short half-life, like what happened, beyond last year, doesn't matter for weekly, weekly. For weekly signal. Right? And therefore we can differentiate between the slow pace trend followers. They use a large half-life. So therefore, they use the recent data that is much larger.
So,
yes, of course, yes. It's just rescaling the weight. So. Because this is just illustration, but each observation will have its own deal dependent on the scale of this observation and the scale of half-life parameter. So now we normalize. So we normalize volatility. It's not normalizing. They are already normalized. We smooth them, right? So we get into time series that already looks more stable. So in this example, I use a half-life of 2 months. So we are close to something that looks like stationary. Obviously, there are many ways to do this smoothing, right? The only point is, again, whenever you use something, the raw signal must have standard deviation of one, of close to one, right? So therefore, for this simple filter, we can compute the theoretical standard deviation and just normalize the signal, or we can use something different, right? So this is a raw signal that actually goes into signal generator further. It looks like a stationary signal, right? That goes is approximately normal. So it's bounded by minus 2, minus 3. And this is uniform across all instruments. The way to think of it is that there are apples and oranges. When both of them are squeezed, we get juice, right, that we can package further. So once everything has the same shape, then we can consider it in uniform way. And now signal. So this is raw signal. And as again, most of the programs, they run continuously. So you actually, you are not putting any kind of stop losses, or you always rebalance your position according to the strength of your signal, right? So here in the extreme, you would be short. And once your signal changes, you start gradually build up closing short and building up long. And to do that, usually we want to map something that again, between, it's either minus one or plus one, right? And so effectively the idea is to avoid, say, I don't want to put, so there are many ways. Say, one is I'm just looking at the sign of time series. And if it's negative, then I short. If it's positive, I'm long, right? But if it's, say, I get something very extreme, like a signal is minus 10, then probably I don't want to be, it's the question, should I adjust position size to signal or not? So there are different ways. One is to use binary, one is to use cap linear, and another is to use more like convex functions or concave. It has impact, I'll show you examples. It has impact on turnover. And here we go. So it's again using pound as example. We transform the smooth raw signal into position size. So each of them, so binary will be either always will be either long or short, right? So there are sustainable periods that it was long. Then it went short, and more or less all the all these mappings they have maybe different magnitude how they adjust the position, but they are more or less in the same direction.
So what's the reasoning behind using sigmoid?
Sigmoid is to avoid again if the signal is very strong, say it becomes too negative, it's either. Like, do you think it's an outlier? Maybe it's not. But do you want to trade it? Maybe not. So therefore, this sigmoid is just degree how you adjust the extreme values of signal.
Sorry, is there a difference in terms of performance? I mean, final performance, you get mostly skewed, you use the sigmoid rather than...
That's a very good question. And I have illustration in a few slides. But that's exactly the point. The point is not to look only at the performance, the point is to look at risk profile. So here we go. So now we can generate position sizes. And the next also, because this will be uniformly across, so it's for everything. For apples and oranges, we just get a position size, right? And say for soy and for 10-year treasury, but we need to size the risk. And the risk sizing is usually done using volatility targeting, that both soy and 10-year treasury must have the same contribution to my portfolio risk, assuming that their correlation between is zero. So therefore, we need to measure again volatility. We need volatility to measure volatility both for scaling and also for targeting volatility. So here I use exponential, is again exponentially weighted volatility for pound. So obviously it had peak in during global financial crisis, and then we transform into position sizing. So whenever we had In financial crisis, volatility was very high. We scaled down the position, right? That we have another risk-adjusted rule that tries to equalize the contribution of volatility from each contract. So just summarize, it's again, it's, there are many layers, few layers to build up a trend following system. So first is a period for returns computation. It has relatively weak impact. It has higher impact for transaction cost. Then half-life parameter. This is the parameter with the highest impact. The smaller half-life, the more rapidly changing signal. Mapping of signal into position is modest impact. Volatility targeting also is mostly set by your risk appetite, that you want to target volatility 10% or 20%. And portfolio allocation. So usually people use equally weighted. If you have more resources, you can look into how to build up more optimized versions of allocators with some covariance estimates. And here we go. So I will apply just to illustrate the idea. So for each contract, I will apply trend following strategies with half-life parameter for 2 months and using capped linear map of signal with wall target of 15%. So this is just indicative. It's not to convince you of anything. There are no transaction cost. So first of all, the good thing, it has positive expectation. So even, and also positive skewness, that's the most important. So it has positive expectation positive skewness, each of them. So actually some perform better, some perform worse, but on average it's positive and also skewness. This is more important, the skewness and the beta with respect to the currency. So for, for Swiss franc, actually negative. The only example of for pound, actually, 10 convexity beta of 10 means that when pounds drop by 1%, the trend following strategy is expected to generate a return of 1%. So each of them has positive skew convexity. And here is the performance of this trend following. Of portfolio of these 7 trend following strategies, weighted against delta one basket, being that you invest in 7 currencies and just roll the positions equally weighted each month. So we see the green line is the trend following, right? So you see, obviously, it's why people like it. It performed well in 2008 during risk aversion and more later in 2014 when there was strong dollar rally. And this is, again, we see, even for this simple example, we see the positive convexity. So here I have monthly return on delta one basket, right, against return on the trend following strategy, consisting of the 7 instruments, right? So trend following always tend to perform well for outsized changes in the market. Why people in institutional space, why they like it? It's whenever you have like a strategy, maybe you have a carry strategies, why you think of as overlay, that you expect trend following to perform well in extreme conditions. And now we're going back to your point. Now we will explore the just simple way, what affects. So we have a few meta parameters. What affect which? So first of all, simulated sharp of as function of signal half-life. So here we have kind of the strongest is for 2 months. So and obviously the longer half-life becomes is no sharp. This is similar for equities. It's almost somewhat similar that. Signals with short half-life, they tend not to perform well on short scale, like of half-life. Like usually for equities, sharp is more stable once you increase the horizon, but It's mostly because equities perform well for fixed income the same. Although for equities, usually I expect signal half-life must be more about 4 months. So each asset class may have peaks, different peaks for Sharpe ratio as function of half-life. And on the other hand, skewness, right? So the strategies with short filter, they tend to have higher skewness. Right? And once you increase the signal half-life, you can become close to either long or either short. You don't change your position fast enough. And the same for convexity beta. So effectively, you generate good convexity, good defensive property when your half-life is relatively short. And then looking for sharp as function of signal mapping. So usually these smooth functions, they generate more or less uniform sharp. Binary, for some reason, is an outlier. But usually when you account cost, then usually why you prefer something smoother. Binary tend to have maybe too many switches. And so also skewness is relatively stable across different mappings. Maybe for sigmoid 4, it's tends to limit. One signal is too outsized, it tends to limit, and somewhat it tends to lose this convexity. So, and the final question that is what's about correlations, right? That does it help me to diversify my trend following strategies within asset class? So here I have correlation matrix is for delta one strategies. So for continuously rolling the futures. So it's more or less average correlation 45%. So obviously like we see Aussie dollar is correlated with New Zealand dollar. So there are some decorrelated pairs. Overall correlation is strong. For trend following also, they tend to be within the same asset class. When dollar increases, all trend following strategies tend to perform well because they end up being long dollar. Right? But still there's some reduction in correlation. And the point is how to use this. So if say we want to do a little bit more advanced portfolio allocation, right, and one way to look at it is to look at principal components, right? So again, here the first matrix is, so what we can do, we can compute, say, in sample, it's all in sample computations, so take returns of these assets, compute and compute PCA decomposition, and then look at the loadings, factor loadings, how much each currency is exposed to the first loading, to the first principal component. Right, and so on. So obviously they are all exposed to, the first one is being say parallel shift. So why it's more or less uniform measure. Because again, when dollar appreciates, it appreciates against everything. Maybe only yen tends to be in its own leak, right? And second component is maybe some twists. And when we apply for PCA, for trend following, PCA for trend following, we also see that usually it's impossible to diversify the first principal component that is typically the most significant. There is a very interesting paper from CFM, effectively what are they saying, that instead of doing risk parity, so in some sense risk parity would be doing on everything on accounting on all correlation, on all correlation matrix, whereas they say, okay, just do risk parity, allocate to the first component with the equal risk contribution. So within this bucket, we would allocate more to yen, right? So to Australian dollar, within this bucket, probably the one that has higher exposure to these components, those currencies must be reduced. And in this way, we achieve kind of diversification of these principal components. And the reason is that principal components, they tend to be more stable than the correlations. But this is very research intensive area. So yeah, so what I presented was a Bayes strategy, very indicative strategy. Usually what you can do further is intraday signal generation and intraday execution. Then also interesting is to have actually some feeling, what is autocorrelation, how do we measure, how do I expect, should I be always in the market or should I somehow track the autocorrelation? And also for volatility models, we can use different normalizations. Time smoothing can also, instead of using weighted moving average, we can use more advanced econometric tools. And finally, is portfolio allocation. And here I have two slides left. Something that I talked about, volatility estimation, right? That effectively in this strategy, we have meta parameters. What volatility model should I use? Right? And the way to think, it goes back to this overfitting problem, right? Usually in strategy design, one space is say volatility models. I can have different volatility models. On the other spectrum, I can have different strategy parameters. And obviously brute force would be to find what is the best combination that gives me the most optimal result, right? This is bound to not work in out of sample. Instead, what we should do is to split, right? To split the problem. First, find the best model for estimation volatility. Given that model, kind of try to guess or forecast what are the best parameters for strategy execution. And the final slide is very interesting. People like to learn, talk about machine learning. I will talk about statistical learning. This was and one of the interesting concepts is this minimum description lens. It was developed in 1980s. The point is, how do I describe data? Famous Occam razor, it tells you the model that takes fewer assumptions is the best descriptor of your data. This minimum description lens is just a formalization of this idea, that you should look for models that does best prediction for your data out of several hypotheses. And then it says effectively, when we look at data, we look in both data itself and the model, right? And the Kolmogorov complexity says that if you find a model, say, that conditional on the on this model, you are better to describe. You have more predictive power to describe the data, right? Then this will be the leading terms in your program that you can reduce. Effectively, you can think of any data, you can think as a large string, right? And if we find some particularities in that string, then we can reduce the dimension of this, right? And that actually the information that if we have a good model, the information that we are missing is actually very small. So that's to conclude is again, layered models, like right, what I showed, everything is layered. Normalization, smoothing, allocation, right? That for each layer we can find, we don't need to look at performance of particular strategy, we just find a model that fits best this layer without actually looking at P&L. And so, and finally, I have some papers on these topics, and I try to keep regular updates in my blog, and you can follow me on Twitter. So that's all. Thank you for attention. questions?
Do you use any technical indicators in order to identify trends or?
No. Mostly it's data driven, but it's an interesting topic. Yeah.
Have you ever tried to use that, or you don't believe?
I don't believe in technical stuff. I more believe like in regimes switching, like in regime estimation, and in doing conditional allocation. I think this is possible. That effectively in my second presentation I talk about this. It's again what, like as I said, trend following perform well when there is autocorrelation. Right? In opposite, say short volatility strategies perform well when there is mean reversion. And carry strategies perform well when it's periods of low volatility. And therefore, conditional, if we can forecast the regimes, we can increase change allocations to these strategies.
Another one question. Do you use any quantitative techniques in order to have a portfolio more like one asset in order to see trend following strategies? Do you
use things like this? No. Effectively, I think, yes, it's one possibility. Another possibility, like, yeah, I see what you say.
Yeah. In other portfolios, do you use any integration techniques?
Not at this moment. Thank you again, and have a nice day.